Well, let's return to the situation in Ukraine and also President Putin's speech this morning. With me in the studio, defence analyst Professor Michael Clark. What did you make of what President Putin had to say, Michael?
Yeah, well, Jane, it was full on. It was the argument that we know he's made, that Russia is actually fighting for its survival. And he's justifying the sacrifices that the Russians are going to have to make by saying that this is a real struggle for our existence. Russia is now fighting against the whole of the West. And he was really saying, you mentioned the oligarchs, and said, well, if the oligarchs lose their property abroad, so what? They ought to come home. And he was really talking about bringing everybody back into the tent, bringing people around him that he needs. And so, you know, there are people in the front row like Patrushev, who's really important. That's Patrushev just there. And he's effectively, he's the national security advisor, but he's the ideologue. Patrushev is the man who's inside Putin's head. And my goodness, the things he has believed for the last 30 years would make your hair curl. Astonishing. And so he's there. And what Putin's really saying, I mean, people like, you know, him and Bordnikov and Kovalchuk, the banker, the billionaire banker, these are the people that Putin gets around. I mean, he wants the other oligarchs to actually come back and get on board with the national struggle. That's really what he's saying. Quite an interesting element. You wouldn't have expected him to talk about the oligarchs, but he did, and he turned it into a sort of matter of patriotism.
He also talked about nuclear weapons and also the announcement of the suspension of Russia's participation in the START nuclear treaty. How concerned should we be about that, do you think?
Yeah, it's interesting. It's called the New START. This goes back, in a sense, to the late 1960s. It began as a SALT process, Strategic Arms Limitation Talks, and then START, Strategic Arms Reduction Talks. The first treaty was in 1972, so it goes back, you know, 50-odd years. Mm-hmm. And the new START was concluded by Obama in 2010, with Medvedev there when he was president, and it came into force in 2011. In 2021, it was extended for 5 more years, till 2026, and Putin has pulled out of it. Now, in reality, that doesn't make that much difference because the New START treaty was only to agree to carry on doing what they were already doing. It didn't force them to reduce anything. It just put a sort of a cap on what they were anyway planning to do. So it won't make a lot of practical difference. But symbolically, it's quite important because the whole strategic arms process, this agreement between Russia and America on their intercontinental ballistic missiles targeted at each other, was like the tip of a pyramid. And underneath that pyramid were deals on tactical nuclear weapons, intermediate forces, on conventional forces, chemical weapons, biological weapons. There was a great pyramid of arms control, all based on the fact that there was this thing at the top between the two superpowers. Now, in reality, most of what was in that pyramid has gone over the years. And this it left the tip, as it were, presiding over almost nothing. But to lose it means that it would be much more difficult now to build that pyramid up again at some time in the future. So, symbolically, quite important. In practical terms, won't make any difference to their nuclear arsenals.
Okay, but what about what is actually happening on the ground? We're reaching that one-year anniversary.
Yeah.
What is the situation at the moment?
Yeah, more of the same, mainly in the Donbass. I mean, this is almost certainly is where the Russians are going to push when their offensive really starts. I don't believe it's really started yet. I think when it does, we'll know about it. But it's all in the Donbass and three particular places that we've mentioned many times. Crimea in the north, which is the Russians have to hold Crimea, and they're pushing back with numbers of troops, not with any great skill, but they're pushing back and forcing the Ukrainians to give ground in Crimea. Bakhmut, they may take that by the end of the week. They've got almost every route to Bakhmut now covered, if not actually physically occupied. I suspect the Ukrainians may have to withdraw from Bakhmut, but they might hang on beyond the end of the week in order to prevent the Russians getting the benefit of an anniversary victory. And then mainly in Vuhledar, the Russians have lost an enormous number of troops. There have been two major battle tactical groups there, almost, and two good ones as well, the 155th and the 40th Marines. And they seem to have lost most of them, which means that they're combat ineffective, which means that they've lost more than 30% of their troops. That's the normal definition of being combat ineffective. And the RMOD, our defence intelligence people in London, say they've become combat ineffective. So very expensive for the Russians, but they're pushing. But they're pushing on areas that they used to control. There's nothing new in this. They're just expending a lot of manpower and blood in order to keep the Ukrainians fighting. And I think the real offensive will start sometime, in the next few weeks. Hasn't started yet, in my view.